you would take your red hymn books with me this evening and turn over to page number 374. Page 374. Turn back to page number 56. Page 56. Brother Jimmy, could you please ask a blessing over that?
Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us. Thank you, Lord, for the blood you shed and the life you gave on the cross, Lord, to pay our debt for our sins. Thank you, Lord, that your grace is greater than all of our sins. We pray, Lord, as we hear the preaching of your word, that you will help us to align our hearts with your word and with your will. Help us, Lord, to humble ourselves to the working of your word and your Holy Spirit here today, that we may be obedient to what you would have us to do. We do ask, Lord, if there's one among us that does not know you or your salvation, today be the day they come to know you as your Savior, their Savior. We pray, Lord, that we will be quick to give you the honor and glory, Lord, in all that is accomplished here today. We pray, Lord, that we may bless the name of the Lord here today with all that is said and done. Mm-hmm. We ask, Lord, you'll take this offering, bless it, multiply it, use it for your kingdom work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. May remain seated and turn over to page number 401. Page 401.
Set my soul afire, Lord, for thy holy.
this evening. Turn over to page number 356. Page 356.
Singing, ready for great preaching. Amen. Brother Ethan, you come. Thank you so much. Okay, Father.
Good evening. If you take your Bibles and turn to Exodus chapter 2. I had to ask Pastor Jim if it was Jochebed or Jochebed. For the first 2 weeks, I pronounced it Jochebed, and then I heard someone else say Jochebed, and I was really concerned. But either or. Exodus chapter 2, when you find your spot, please stand to honor the reading of God's word. We're just going to kick off with the first two verses. It says, "And there went a man of the house of Levi, and took to wife a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months." I want to bring my message tonight entitled, "The Call of Jochebed." Let's pray. Lord, I want to thank you for today. I thank you for the morning service and bringing us back safely this evening. Thank you so much for the songs we're able to sing and lift up glory to your name. And I pray that that theme would be continued as we open up your word. As it goes forward, Lord, I pray that you prepare our hearts for it, help us to receive it, and give us understanding on how to apply it to our walk with you. Thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all want a good Mother's Day analogy? Well, it was one of my last clinicals and only my second ambulance experiences in Livingston. Hold on, let me change my brightness on this real quick. I'm getting old, my eyesight's. Second ambulance experience in Livingston, and I'm at the basics of the basic, EMT assisting, ready to help those in need. It's like 7:05, not even 5 minutes of being there, and the loud, scary radio calls in a however old female with a water break. And my heart skips a beat. You know, it's that same feeling. You've just been in a car crash, and you're scared. You don't know what to do. You just know something needs to be done, AKA panic. Because I'm potentially about to help assist some paramedics in delivering a baby. Before that day, I made it a point of prayer. It's like, God, show me more analogies out of my experiences. And next thing you know, Mother's Day coming up and it's baby delivering time. The timing was also good because we had just learned about this subject right before, the class right before. But per usual, the application for this subject is always way more stressful. When you're out there, it's as real as it gets. We didn't even go to the hospital. Right there, parked in the front yard. And 15 minutes later, we had a successful delivery on the spot. Let me tell you, that was stressful. Meanwhile, I'm petrified with what in the world I just witnessed. I was thinking EMT school, right? It's like light nursing, maybe some extensive studying. There was nowhere in my head, or especially where I signed up, to wake up at 5 in the morning, drive to Livingston, and be traumatized like that. Oh, Ethan, you're being immature. You know, childbirth's a beautiful thing. People who say that are liars, and they need glasses. On top of that, my preceptor, which is the paramedic the students get assigned to, said in the 9 years of work that was the first time that situation came up. Wonderful, I thought. But in my mind, I thought it was even more ironic that the very class before was all about preparing me for that situation. When you're in it and your adrenaline's rushing, the only thing you have to rely on is what in the world your teacher was talking about. There are too many what-ifs when it comes to emergency services, but I gotta say that I was impressed with the process the class takes you through to get you on the field. Take the first step, for example, literally just walking up to the patient. In your head, you perform the general assessment, which is 8 very annoyingly hard to memorize steps for that process. But when you have those 8 steps down that seem to be really extra, it makes sense. Because when life is at threat, there are specific things that need to be looked for. And the details of that process gives you the best chance of not missing anything and providing the best care and the best order. So yeah, it may be annoying to show up for 4 hours twice a week, but that time of preparation was crucial. The job of emergency service is to remain calm during terrifying situations and order your thoughts into what you have learned. That's what makes a good EMT, and likewise, that's what makes the successful Christian. Among this ever-darkening world, it's easy to drop what we learn and focus on the present. If it's only a momentary habit or an ongoing anxiety, that is a hindrance to your faith. Thinking of it, and in this sense, for EMT, the idea of distractions are mainly what's distracting. I don't know how many times I felt my mind have to move on when the situation wanted me to feel stuck. Forgo the information I learned in class was very important. This gives me all the more respect for my teacher, Mr. Freeman. You know, teachers, they get a bad rap. They deal with teenagers. They're underpaid, all the while educating the next generation. In my opinion, it's a very noble profession, and Mr. Freeman's going to help a lot of people training up EMTs to go save lives. There are teachers that provide this opportunity, in this sense, to become successful in the most important parts of life. It is Mother's Day, and the job of a mother in preparing a child from scratch to live a successful life despite the darkness of the world. After the fact, I'm watching the baby being held by his mom and dad. And what makes the whole idea of the situation intense is all the screaming that gets done. But I watched or listened as it went from 100 to 0, the face of the mother nonstop smiling, not taking a second to look away from the baby. I thought to myself, wow, that is the beginning of keeping your eyes on that child. I am Ethan, so I'll never know what it means to be a mom, but I was blessed with a wise one, and she taught me exactly how much a mother is called to give, an extent that knows no bounds. So tonight I want to take away what the Christian can learn from the mom position. I was thinking hard about which mother to learn from in the Bible, and I chose one whose name might be unfamiliar to you. Because it's only mentioned twice in the entire Bible, and it's not tailored to her real story. She was the mother of Moses, and her name was Jochebed. Her story is in the book of Exodus. It's important to know the context here. It's the second book of the Bible, and it picks up right after Genesis, which ended with Abraham's grandson, Jacob, leading his big family down to Egypt. Jacob's 11th son, Joseph, was brought up in his second command over all of Egypt, and then he saved his family through that big famine. So Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, offered his family to come live there as a safe haven. Eventually, Jacob and Joseph, the rest of his family, passes. About 400 years go by, and the story of the Exodus begins. The name refers to what happens in the first half of the book, where they are exiting, Israel's exodus from Egypt. Centuries have passed, and chapter Exodus 1, verse 7 says that the Israelites were fruitful and that they filled the land. This is significant because it echoes back to the blessing that God gave humanity in the Garden of Eden. It reminds us of the big biblical picture so far, that humanity forfeited God's blessing through sin and rebellion. So God chose Abraham and his family to carry out his will to restore that blessing. But the new Pharaoh does not view Israel as a blessing. He is the worst. He views it as a threat to his power. So just like in Genesis, humanity rejects God's blessing, and Pharaoh sought to destroy this, the source of God's blessing. The Israelites, through brutal enslavement and then an ultimate decree, as sung by Kalen this morning, to drown all the baby boys. God first, that didn't roll off the tongue as well as I did, thought it was. God first turns Pharaoh's evil upside down with Jochebed in these short 10 verses. Because of the kids she would raise, the nation would soon be led with God's plan. The unsung hero, if you will. Throughout this passage, she's just referred to as a woman or as Moses' mother. You don't have to turn there, but in Numbers 26:59, we get her name. Verse 26, verse 59 says, "And the name of Abram's wife was Jochebed, the daughter of Levi, whom her mother bare to Levi in Egypt, and she bare unto Amram, Aaron, and Moses, and Miriam, their sister." So, you know, it's a simple introduction. Who she came from, who she's married to, and who came from her. The only information given to her name was her genealogy, which is often throughout the history for women. But the Bible in no way neglects her legacy. While she's not called by name, her story is very powerful, and it's what gives the nation success in beginning the Exodus. Let's reread chapter 2, verse 2. "And the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months." From this we see Jochebed's resolve, which is number one of three characteristics we'll see tonight. More specifically, Jochebed had a brave resolve. I imagine troops of Egyptian soldiers patrolling the land, examining every woman, making note of who was pregnant, keeping up with the times, and demanding to see the children as soon as they're born. They seized every boy child who was born in Goshen, but Jochebed somehow managed to conceal her son for 3 whole months. What outlines her resolve is that it was done from the beginning. In our verse, it says that she saw him that he was a goodly child. Jochebed didn't fear the judgment of man. She perceived Moses' potential and put her life on the line for that potential for 3 months. The consistency that's called for in a mother's resolve and how they're called to dedicate their life to their children is top tier, and the Christian life should be reflective of that. Jochebed didn't just see some baby. She saw his potential to be used by God. There are an infinite of lessons to be drawn from his will, the Bible, and he would like us to have resolve in growing ourselves from them, learning them, and stewarding all that there is to offer. It is a lifelong pursuit, and there's always the excuse of, "Oh, I'm old, I've done my time," or, "I'm young, I've got plenty of time left." But as Christians, we can't base our schedule on the world's perspective like that. As you can see, those two led right into one another. From that first point of realization when you were saved, when you applied yourself as a sinner to a scripture, and Pastor Jim said that this morning, that the Holy Spirit begins to work, opening your heart and mind to the fact that you are indeed lost without God. And then the key part, that you now need a Savior. All right, that provoked to action is our potential being used. And we see this is the way Jochebed saw Moses' value in being used by God. It's how God wants us to view our Christian walk. Our record of obedience, our Christian life, should be as precious as a mother sees her son's life. Jochebed's obedience was a test for her resolve towards God's will. And as we pursue God's will and his word is presented, it's of utmost importance to dwell on it, to memorize it, and then very important to recite it. The spear point of your scripture memory should be scripture used against temptation. And I mean, besides scripture for growth and obedience sake, I'm talking about when there's a specific temptation prevalent in your life, then God's word has a specific scripture that works perfectly to defend against the way your flesh works. It's a miracle, but it takes work, reading and studying, and it is time consuming, and it asks your inner discipline, is this worth searching for, let alone making the lifestyle out of it, changing by it? Well, that's what makes having a strong resolve so important. I mentioned earlier that Jochebed had a brave resolve. I said that because she lived purely on the trust of God for the future. We got it easy these days with the safety net of a civilized society, but Jochebed's president was drowning baby boys. No matter the tailored situation or how intense, God is patiently waiting for your resolve to let him direct your situation. Next characteristic that we see Jochebed has is she's had a lovely faith. A lovely faith, which is a big part of my last sermon, so it's fresh on my mind, but it has to be mentioned for Mother's Day. The love of a mother is very much unique and special, and we see here Jochebed displaying it with her faith to the T. Let's read chapter 2, verse 3. It says, "And when she could not longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes and dabbed it with slime and with pitch, and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flags by the river's brink." When Jochebed hid her son for 3 months, she exercised her faith. But when she made a basket to put Moses in, she showed the strength of her faith. We see the true measure of her love as it's referenced all the way back in Hebrews chapter, you don't have to turn there, Hebrews 11, 23. It says, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandments." Their love for their child was greater than the fear they had for the king's command. And we see how great the love is, and it outlines what was truly at stake. But because of her first and foundational love for God, those high stakes didn't produce fear, and they didn't cause her to falter in God's plan. Her resolve was shown by being obedient from the start, but then her loving faith was acted out as she had the mindset of finishing strong, doing everything with her power, whether it looked like it was gonna be the end or not. In our verse, she didn't have the ability to hide him anymore, so she didn't hesitate to follow through on this way bigger call of faith. She had no way of knowing that anyone was going to intervene with Moses. She had to have been strategic in her placement, but she did not know that God had already made provisions for him. All she knew was that, I'm jumping ahead of myself, provisions for Moses. She didn't grow up hearing about David killing Goliath and Jesus' resurrection and all of God's miracles. All she knew at the time was that she didn't want her son to be killed. So she obeyed and put him in God's hand. And that is the greatest form of love derived from a mother position. To not take pride in the process and the work it takes to raise a child, but having the ultimate goal of raising them to serve God progressively. That's why I love this church. The emphasis on kids in church is huge for popularity's sake, and that's sad, but the idea of kids stepping up to serve in church is something I had the privilege of, I got to respect growing up with here. And now seeing what comes from it, the personal spiritual victories, as well as the hope for the future of this church. Amen. And what all that entails comes from a foundational love and faith for God in each individual. All of this necessary growth and hope to keep going strong as a church family starts with your love as a member. When you understand your service for each position, like a mother dedicated to the bigger picture, then you get to experience God's control. Philippians 3:10 depicts it well, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. It's a sad thought because of a lack of love with faith, many take that last part for granted. You know, never fully experiencing the circle of having the knowledge of God, knowing his power, and then knowing the why behind our sufferings and the comfort that's offered there to us as Christians. But because of whatever sin, situation, or excuse, our flesh's pride can restrict us from fully wanting to conform and change ourselves according to that will. Those first three things, they can all be observed by the sluggard, someone who's only half in. But to be a part of something as big as Jochebed's situation and come out victorious took a love so grand that she was willing to put her life aside and reflect Christ. Which part of Christ's life? The obedient part, which was the entirety of his life, but the biggest and most important act of obedience, his death. when Jesus was too young, and he ran off from Mary and Joseph, and they found him and asked him, "What in the world are you doing?" He responded in Luke 2:49, "Wish ye not that I must be about my Father's business." And he continued in his Father's business with full force throughout his life. Likewise, Jochebed dropped the value of her life, and with a pure love for God, she pursued the blessing of her son. So we see, because of Jochebed's immense love behind her faith, it first gave her a direction in her walk, and then it prevented distractions by focusing on the bigger picture. When God's bigger plan is prioritized, it should give us a backbone to serve God. The fear of stepping up in front of people or up to bigger responsibilities is a mind game that will keep you occupied for as long as you would like. Alternatively, a quick shift in priorities and growing to reflect the love shown in Exodus 2:3 here will leave you in God's very capable hands. Side note, but it's super important, that the basket Moses was placed in is symbolic of the ark, which carried Noah and his family safely when God destroyed wickedness off the face of the earth. The ark of Noah and the basket of Moses point to the salvation of Jesus Christ. Noah and Moses were made secure in the ark, just as we are made safe through Christ. The very thought provides resolve, right? But as we gain experience and live life, we realize that our love for faith is something that this flesh can falter in. So it's crucial to prioritize our focus of it. Let's see where that focus gets Jochebed, beginning in verse 4, and I'll read down to verse 10. "And his sister stood afar off to wit what would be done to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him and said, 'This is one of the Hebrews' children.' Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, 'Shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee?' And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Go.' And the maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, 'Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages.' And the woman took the child and nursed it. And the child grew, and she brought unto Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son, and she called his name Moses. And she said, 'Because I drew him out of the water.'" God works in ways that are worth retelling. And what a way to bring your child into the world. Pharaoh's daughter, of all people, sees and thankfully adores Moses' crying face, giving his sister the opportunity to suggest getting a Hebrew nurse. The maid goes and fetches none other than Jochebed. The third characteristic shown here is self-control. Can you imagine the level of self-control Jochebed demonstrated when she stood in front of Pharaoh's daughter and accepted the care and wages for the very son whom Pharaoh wanted to destroy? It takes a certain presence of mind to exhibit grace under pressure like that, and she did it. She raised her son as another woman's child, and then, at the appointed time, she handed him over to her care. That takes a lot of self-control and discipline. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." Jochebed very much had a sound mind to continue in the work, never letting her pride get in the way. As living sacrifices, God has already set us apart for his purpose and declared us acceptable because he sees us in our position of Christ, which turns on the present like nobody's business, because Ethan is being seen in his position of Christ right now. And has been since I've been saved a long time ago. The question is, have I gotten a correlating amount of service done for that time? No, I haven't. There's no way. So with that said, I learned that I don't got time for pride to be in control when there's an active work to be a part of. In other words, we don't have to wait to be better people before we offer our bodies and lives to Christ. As people in Christ, he will receive the sacrifice of our everyday lives right now. Also of great importance, our passage ends here with the origin of Moses' name. Now, whether or not Moses' biological mother named him, Scripture gives the baby no name until now. She names him Moses because she drew him out of the water. The Hebrew word for Moses sounds similar for the word draw out, and it represents both an escape from early death, and then it carries that theme later as God uses him to draw Israel out and lead him in the Exodus. Jochebed's name means Jehovah gloried, or whose glory is Jehovah, which is really neat. I love the way her name hints at how God used her to save the child who would eventually become the man God used for an act of deliverance. Way back in chapter 1, where Pharaoh was planning his evilness, his mindset was that he wanted the Israelites to be there as his servants. He just didn't want them there and powerful enough to revolt. So why did God plan for them to start a family during such a dark period? Because the only way to combat the darkness is to raise up strong and women and men and women of the faith. And we see upon reviewing her whole story just how much she was called to give and her gratitude in stewarding her gift from God. The lessons we learn from Jochebed are that of resolve, love, and self-control. When faced with her greatest fear, she didn't panic. She boldly executed God's plan with full force. The Bible doesn't mention it, but we know that she must have had a strong prayer life. I believe Jochebed had a personal connection with her relationship with God. She didn't take it lightly, and she certainly didn't do it for anyone to hear about how great she was. Jochebed was a true case of pushing forward with faith for the sake of faith. Jochebed knew as long as she trusted God that she had nothing to worry about. Likewise, in the effort of living day by day, we must not forget what's supplied to us. We have a perfect will to go by, and so much can be accomplished by trusting in it. I'll leave those thoughts with you and close this out for invitation. Lord, I want to thank you for today. I thank you for your word, and I thank you for this record of Jochebed and how in the most challenging times that she chose to trust and obey you. And I pray that we grow to reflect that with our lives. I pray that if anyone here doesn't know that trust, Lord, if they don't know salvation, that you burn their heart to make that wonderful decision. Thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Page 277. I hope if God showed you something from the life of Jochebed, that you use this time accordingly.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest, trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust.
Now. Yeah, okay, each time. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for your prayers. The Lord knows I need them, and I very much appreciate them. Hope I was able to shed some light on the characteristics of Jochebed tonight. If it wasn't convicting, I hope it served as an encouragement. That said, Pastor Jim, would you close us out with a word of prayer?
Now, Father, we want to thank you for the great privilege it is to be in your house tonight, Lord, and to be able to be under the preaching of your word. Thank you, Brother Ethan. Thank you for his time in study. For the wonderful truths that are brought from this passage, we just want to give you the praise and glory for it. We thank you, Lord, that you meet our every need. And Lord, all the things that you lay before us, how much it shows us that we need to be a people of faith, that we can trust you, Lord, that you desire to use it all in a great, great way. I pray, God, that we're surrendered to you, Lord, that we're yielded, and that we're desiring to be able to see your hand at work. Thank you, Lord, for salvation. And I pray, Father, that you would continue to remind us of the wonderful message that we have of Jesus Christ. As we go about from this place, Lord, I pray, God, that you would help us to be mindful of those that we come into contact with in Christ. Lord, help us to always live the faith that we have. Help us, Lord, be willing to speak and tell others about the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Thank you so much for the night, and we pray, Father, that you'd watch over us as we depart from this place. See us safely back at the next appointed time. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.